can't just be advocates talking to politicians. We have to create a big table. We have to bring the best and brightest around and sit at that table and ask some very important questions. What's going to be the rate of innovation? What is your industry able to do? What's a date that we can all come up with that will drive a marketplace and economic development around eliminating pollution? And who are going to be the people at the table who are going to commit that their companies are going to do that kind of investment and that kind of innovation, because we've got rewards in store for companies in doing it? And what are the policies we have to write to make it happen? We will change the entire planet. Because there's no issue that's coming home to roost faster than water. If anybody hasn't seen the current issue of National Geographic, I invite you to grab it. The story is finally starting to come out. And the story, in a word, is a scandal that we've allowed this to happen. But we can change it and we can turn it around. And if we need any further evidence of this, Lisa Jackson, new administrator of the EPA, wrote a memo to her staff on January 12th. And it was broken up into sections. Here's the first sentence on the section called Protecting America's Waters. This is to the entire EPA staff. America's water bodies are imperiled as never before. In 2010, the administrator of the EPA said, America's waters are imperiled as never before. 38 years after the Clean Water Act was written, America's waters are imperiled as never before. That's the final admission from my book. So, I learned a lot of lessons. I don't do much advocacy anymore. You might not know that to hear me speak, because I do run this research center. But my lessons as an advocate, as a water advocate, that drove me to do the things that I'm doing now, actually to leave the world of advocacy, is that issues only get you so far. I was a plaintiff in more lawsuits, far more lawsuits than the average person has ever a plaintiff. I don't know, 100. I sat across the negotiating table from all manner of polluters, industrial, municipal, state. Some who hid what they were doing, who should have been prosecuted criminally. Some who had no clue what they were doing. And we solved a lot of those cases. But litigation is not a legacy. You know, case law is not a legacy. A legacy is when you change society. A legacy is when you change ways of doing business to make our lives better. Something the next generation can build on. That's what a legacy is. We have not created a legacy on water. And that's our mission. For those of you who are students, there, any field you go into, you can participate in this. You can be one of those innovators. But I have to emphasize to you, the most important thing we need right now is we need intellect. We need talent. We need skills. We need smart people who think differently. Because, this is no offense to anybody else, because I'll be 60 in July, I'm including myself in the picture. Anybody who says to you that the Clean Water Act is successful, anybody who says to you that we're handling water issues in America just fine, is old. They're old people. They're old people who don't know better. They're people who are defending the legacy they thought they created. I'm being unkind now, but you know what? It may be time to be a little unkind. We failed at what we started. But the good news is, we've also built into this society a number, an amount of smart, talented people, of geniuses, of innovators in the United States like no other country has, and we can solve it here. It's going to ride a lot on you guys in the back, and a few of us cheering on the sidelines, but it's going to be the next generation of smart people who are going to do it, and you've got to make that commitment. Pull something up here. And I talked about imagination in the beginning. And the other lesson I learned as an advocate is this, that there is no idea, there's no organization, there's no school, there's no law, there's no piece of innovation that didn't first start with something very simple, which is somebody imagining it. Every great thing begins up here in one person's mind, and then the conversation that follows when that person shares with somebody else. Everything terrific that's happened in our world has begun with an act of the imagination. The number of terrific things that have not happened are because somebody failed to take that next step on what they imagined. And when I was still at Riverkeeper, I was asked to write a letter for a time capsule that was going to be buried in Seattle, Washington, that was going to be unearthed 100 years later. And I thought about what I was going to say in this letter, and it became a really spooky enterprise. And of course, the first thing I thought about is, you know, what are people going to be imagining 100 years from now? And I was never going to be around to know what the letter was ever read. Nobody was ever going to write me back in 2100, of course. I said, what can I even talk about in 2000 that's going to make sense then? There's no sense in talking about computers, because they're going to be in such a different world that I'm not going to know what I'm talking about. And there's no sense in me trying to predict what their issues are going to be. So, let me just take a moment here to read you what I ended up writing. And then we'll have a discussion.